This is Vince, and I want to welcome you to this presentation of the Best of the Best webinar series brought to you by Novedge, the design software superstore. I want to thank all of you for joining us today. We're very excited not only to present tsElements for SolidWorks, but to have Adam O'Hearn on board with us presenting and showing tsElements for SolidWorks. Just a little background on Adam. He's an industrial design consultant based in Santa Monica, California. He's designed everything from Hollywood movie vehicles to real-world laboratory instruments, classroom toys to power tools. He uses SolidWorks, Modo, and Rhino to bring his ideas from concept to reality and publishes video training at cadjunkie.com. So needless to say, he's really, truly an expert at what he does, and we're blessed to have him on board. Adam's going to speak for about the next 40 minutes or so. During that time, everyone will be in listen-only mode, but please feel free to send your questions into the question box. At the end, we'll open it up for a Q&A, and we'll get to as many questions as time allows. We will be recording this webinar, and it'll be made available online to all of you. We'll have details on where to find it and how to get it as soon as Adam's done. With having said that, I want to stop talking and get things shifted over to Adam. Adam, can you hear me?
I can. Can you hear me?
Yep. I'm going to switch the screen over to you, and we'll go ahead and get things going.
Sweet. Let's see what we... Let's see, I'll show you this little PowerPoint first. All right, can you see that? Hope so. Looks like you probably can. All right, well, greetings everybody. As you just heard, my name is Adam O'Hearn, and I'm an industrial designer and founder of cadjunkie.com. And we have got some, I hope we've got some CAD junkies on the line today. If you haven't checked it out, definitely recommend taking a look. A lot of what we're going to do today is going to be really familiar to folks who follow us on CAD Junkie or on Twitter at the CAD Junkie. A lot of what we'll be talking through today is pretty much stuff we've already covered on the site, but I'm going to go into a little bit more depth, hopefully, today. So, as you know, today we're going to be talking about workflow possibilities with tsElements for SolidWorks. And I personally use tsElements in my studio, and it has literally changed the way that I use CAD tools in a lot of ways. Not only can I now build organic models a lot more quickly than I used to be able to, but I can create intricate, like hand-sculpted forms that were nearly impossible before T-splines came along. There are two overarching categories of 3D modeling software on the market. Essentially, there are visualization packages like Maya, Lightwave, 3ds Max, Soft Image Blender, or Modo, which is what I'm going to be using today. And then there are CAD packages like Rhino, SolidWorks. And there are tons of competitors in the CAD market, as most of you probably know. tsElements is a plugin for SolidWorks, and it allows you to import polygon mesh data and convert that mesh data to smooth, clean, watertight NURBS surfaces for use in CAD systems like Rhino or SolidWorks. So sub-D packages are really fast and flexible, and they are great for building highly organic models. They're popular with animators because it's easy to build and animate things like humanoid characters, dinosaurs, or in the case of an industrial designer like me, soft goods like shoes or bags. And in this tutorial series I did for Lexology, I kind of demonstrated a little bit of that. Let's see here. Well, and then there's CAD, and CAD systems are like SolidWorks allow me to create forms with mechanical accuracy and precision really easily, as with this project I did for iRobot with Essential Design in Boston. And I've been using Modo as a rendering tool since about 2007, but until very recently, I almost did no modeling at all in Modo because I needed the power that CAD gave me, and I couldn't afford to mess around with sub-D data that I could only use for making pretty pictures, like in this image that was modeled in CAD but then rendered in Modo. So for years, we've really been stuck between these two powerful types of tools, but there's been no easy way of bridging that gap between them. And this is where T-splines and tsElements comes in. So T-splines allows Rhino users to import mesh data from sub-D modeling packages or even model using sub-D-like interface elements right within Rhino. And in the meantime, we SolidWorks users have had to just sit by on the sidelines with envy in our eyes until now. So finally, with tsElements for SolidWorks, I'm able to model highly organic surfaces in Modo and then import those into SolidWorks for adding mechanical details. So I can literally have the best of both worlds here. It's very, very cool. So all of the know-how on which we're about to feast comes in three courses. First, I'm going to introduce basic concepts using extremely simple geometry, just to kind of show you the overall workflow. Second, we'll be using tsElements to import this toy car body from Modo and prep it for rapid prototyping or manufacturing or what have you. And third, after that, if we have time, and I don't know if we will, I'd like to, I really hope I don't ramble for 45 minutes, we'll see. But if we had time, I'd love to throw in some edge weighting and sculpting tools that give Modo 501 and show you how you can actually take advantage of those with tsElements as well. So at the end then, as was mentioned, we'll open it up for discussion and I'll field whatever workflow questions you might have, and we've also got Nick North on the line from T-Splines here to answer if you have any technical questions that I don't necessarily know the answers to. So without further ado, I guess we might as well just jump in. So if nobody nobody objects, then I'll just go ahead and get started. So let's jump over to blank Modo document. I'm going to be assuming that everybody can see this. I'm switching back and forth between apps, and I don't necessarily see what's on your screen. So hopefully you're seeing Modo now, and this is a subd modeling package. As I mentioned, you know, subd is subd, so this could be Maya or Lightwave or whatever you happen to be using to create your mesh data. And for the uninitiated, essentially what I can do here is I'll just throw out a box, and this box, I can at any time I can hit the tab key, which is pretty common in subd modelers to use the tab key to do this, and it smooths out that mesh. So you can see that this box has become sort of a sphere, basically. But if I hit tab again, it goes back to being a box. So it's still a box, it's just being subdivided using an algorithm called subdivision surface modeling, or SDS modeling. And that modeling has a finite resolution. So you can see, as I zoom in, you can see that this box, or this this spheroid shape, is a little bit jagged, right? So I can actually just hit a button on my keyboard and bring that up to make it smoother. So essentially, that's one of the important things to know about typical subd modeling. Traditionally, in subd, you have a finite resolution to work with. You have only so many polygons to work with. And if you zoom in enough, you'll start to see jagged edges, which is one of the reasons why subd is not that good for machining, because you'll end up seeing those jagged edges on the machine surface. Anyway, I'm able to take this and basically bevel up new shapes and pull out some different forms really quickly and easily. So I'm just going to pull some stuff out here, make kind of a random weird shape. Let's go ahead and go inward a little bit just for fun, and go down some. You can see that this would be really fun and addicting. It's not that hard. And if I hit the tab key again, it goes back to the basic cage mesh. And you can see this is what we've been modeling all along. It's just that it looks all smoothed out. And here I can go ahead and do some of that modeling here in the mesh view, just so that you can see what it looks like when I do it like that. Hit the tab key and it goes back. So this is very quick. Now, you know, creating a symmetrical shape like this would be really easy in CAD, but then to try and go through something like this, for example, so like both sides and bevel them both at once, let's bevel those in, shift tab or shift key to reactivate that tool, and I can really easily just create all kinds of different shapes on here. I'm going to go back actually to just a box here. And what I'm, just for fun, I'm going to take this one side and bevel it out a little bit. Let's scale it some, move it out some. I'm going to bevel it and pull it out a long way and add a bunch more geometry in here. I'm not expecting you to follow along step by step. I just want you to see the process overall and get a feel for what subd lets me do. So check this out. I've just created a bunch of geometry here. I can select all of this geometry on the end. I'm going to go to like a side view here and run my bend tool, let's say. Just bend that right on around, something like that. Hit that tab key and you can see that we're creating this kind of wild lamp shape really, really fast and fluid. And you CAD users out there, people that are used to using SolidWorks, are kind of probably getting a little bit green in the eyes right now, because this is really fast compared to what you could do in SolidWorks. But So this is where that big but comes in. Here it is. I've got my shape. I don't know what the heck it's for, but we're ready to make a rapid prototype or something. I can save out an STL file from here, but that is about the extent of what I can do for rapid prototyping in Modo or in most SubD packages. If I want to add mechanical details, if I want to shell this out, I want to punch holes in it, crosses, ribs, whatever, then that stuff is actually ridiculously difficult to do in SubD. SubD is really good at making ooey-gooey gumdrop shapes, but it is not so good for creating mechanical details, and that's where you want to jump into a CAD system like SolidWorks. So what tsElements lets me do is essentially all I have to do is save an OBJ file. So any package you're using that can save an OBJ file will work. That could be Blender, it could be Maya, doesn't matter. So I'm going to go File, Save As here. And I'll just save that right into the folder. We'll call this an OBJ file. And I'll call this my, just for fun, OBJ. So, and then I can just hop over to SolidWorks. So let's see what I can do here. I'm going to try to switch to SolidWorks real quick. This is a little bit different. There we go. Cool. Hopefully you can see that. Now I have tsElements installed on this install of SolidWorks. And bringing in that shape that I just created is as easy as going File, Open. In the normal open dialog box down here with the file type I'm trying to open, I go all the way down to the bottom and I have OBJ as T-spline. Now if you had been working in Rhino and T-splines for Rhino, for example, you saved a T-splines file, a TSM file, and open that instead. But in my case, I'm opening an OBJ file. We'll grab my Just for Fun OBJ and open it up. We'll think for just a second and then bring it on in. And there it is in SolidWorks, just like that. This is cool because right now this is actually a first-class surface. This is just a regular old surface in SolidWorks, and I can do whatever I want with it. And in fact, this is actually a solid body within SolidWorks. If I turn on my section for a second, you're going to see that this is solid all the way through. So because this is a solid body, you SolidWorks users know what that means. I could go to, say, my top view here, open up a sketch, and look normal to the plane. And since we modeled around the origin, it'll be nice and easy. We can put a hole right through the middle here. And this hole is going to be perfectly circular. And this is the part where you Modo users or you sub-D sculptors out there are going to start to get a little bit envious. Because the stuff, what I'm about to do here, i.e. something as simple as just punching a hole in an object that's perfectly circular, that's actually ridiculously annoying to do in sub-D. So really, I'm able to get truly the best of here. I can put fillets, I can do whatever I want to make this object ready for mechanical design, rapid prototyping, whatever. I can add surfaces. Heck, I can even, let's go ahead and run the shell tool. I'll just shell it out, take that surface. Let's take a look at the preview here, see what that does. I don't know how big this thing is, so I don't know how thick to try to make the shell. There we go. Oh, it's really thin, but okay. So there we go. Now I have a solid body that is shelled out. I can throw my my section view on it, and you'll see that this is a solid body with a wall thickness, albeit a very thin one, that is now all the way hollow through and through. So I could send this off to the rapid prototype and dump out the innards through whatever holes I punch in this thing. I can put whatever kind of details I want on this. And another cool thing about this that I probably underutilize, but it's there, is that this is just a feature in the tree. This imported T-spline element is just a feature, and I can click on Edit Feature, and it's going to bring up that mesh data, and you can see that this cage mesh looks exactly like that raw cage mesh that I had in Modo, and I can actually change it right here in tsElements. Now, I'm going to go ahead and admit right off the bat that I don't do this very much because I'd rather make my changes in Modo. I find it a lot easier to do that, and I'll show you why. Here, I'm going to go ahead and click OK so you can see that I've made a change. It's going to think for a second, and then it's going to regenerate all of those changes. So here, I made a change to that base mesh, and I've still got my hole blown in this, and it's still a shelled part. Beautiful. This is a fantastic workflow tool. awesome. But check this out. Now, I'll go back to Modo. Actually, I've got to do it this way. I forgot. Let's go to, just for fun, OBJ. Here we go. So we're back in Modo, and I want to make a really big global change to this thing, let's say. I don't know. Let's put another big tentacle sticking out the front of this guy, just for fun. Loop slice that a little bit, get some more geometry to work with, and take this side. And instead of the bend tool, I'm going to use one of Modo's fun features, which is a radial falloff. I'll just throw out a radial falloff out here, run the move tool, and I can move this so that it kind of bends, and I can adjust my radial falloff so that we've got this kind of tongue thing sticking out here. Looks good. Exit, drop this. If I wanted to make some other changes, go ahead and do that. Nice. Go file, save. I think this is the OBJ. Yeah, it is. So I can just save it. Click save. Go back to SolidWorks. This guy. Here we go. And now I can go edit this feature that I originally opened. And check this out. Right up here, there's a button for replace geometry. I can click that and load geometry. And then go back to this same folder here. Oh, you can't see that right now, can you? Okay, I'm just going to do this real quick. I know you can't see it, but it's just paused it while there's a dialog box up. And I just checked a file that I just saved. And it has gone ahead and replaced that geometry with the newly updated geometry from Modo. I click OK. And now all my features are going to update. They're going to regenerate just the same as before. So I'll end up with the hole in the top and all shelled out and everything. And so this is amazing. So I can do my work in Modo. I can bring it in SolidWorks, add some features. And then when I want to make a change to the base mesh, I just go back to Modo, the tool that I prefer to use anyway. And then I can update that mesh right here in SolidWorks. So as we're going, do feel free to throw out questions if you have them, as you have them. I know that we can field some of those on the fly, and I would love to see what you're thinking as I go. Honestly, it's a little bit awkward to just yammer on for half an hour, but I guess I'll just go ahead and move on to the next thing. So let's open up my other SolidWorks document here. There we go. Hopefully you can see that. Now, again, if you've been watching CAD Junkie for a while, then you've seen this model before, because I've used it a few times, and I used it to demonstrate tsElements a while back, because I think this is a really compelling usage scenario for tsElements and what it can do for a Modo user or for somebody who likes to model in other packages. So if I look at this car body is actually really quick and easy to model in Modo. But adding the mechanical details and the little features, like you can see there's this, the door panel is cut away with this little penny groove. We call that a penny groove in the industrial design world. These little grooves that kind of separate visually different parts of the model. And adding in stuff like this cut where there's this whole separate body here on the bottom, this whole separate dark piece. And on the edges you get these little fillets around the edges. All that stuff is incredibly easy to do in SolidWorks and incredibly hard to do in Modo. But modeling an overall shape like this, just the overall geometry, is incredibly easy to do in Modo and would take a long time to do in SolidWorks. So here's another opportunity to get the best of both worlds. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to hide this original car body that I have here. So we're just left with the wheels. And what I did was I saved the wheels out just like they are here, and then open them up in Modo. So I'm going to hop over to another Modo document that I have open. Here we go. So you can see these wheels are in place. And the wheel, let me just hide this car body for a second. So the wheels come in just as the wireframe. And then I can come in here with whatever tools I want. Like you saw me modeling before, I can make a new mesh item and drag out, say, a box that goes over the area where my wheels are. And really, I just start modeling from there. I can start just kind of grab these guys and bevel them in a bit and bevel up some and, you know, maybe grab some of this front edge here. Move it on back. Grab some of this other stuff. Oop. Move it on up, and you can see how the overall shape of a car body begins to appear very gradually. And it's actually, you know, it's really fast, and I can hit the tab key and it smooths all out, and you've got this really wonky looking shape. But essentially, that's how I built this. So then I, let's look at this other thing. I'll delete that. And I ended up with this. Okay, so this right here takes literally about 8 minutes to model. I've done it a few times because at CADJunkie.com, I'm doing it on how to model this in Modo. And it's very, very quick to knock this out really fast. But to go from here and add, say, the wheel wells into this and just cut out these areas where the wheels go actually is a huge pain in Modo. Same thing with you know, adding edge fillets or adding some of these other details. But I'm going to show you just how easy it is to add details, like organic details, that is, in Modo. So here I'm going to add and grab a few polygons on the front and back of this guy. Hit B for bevel and bevel this guy in just a little, and shift click to reactivate. Bevel that in a little bit more, and shift click to reactivate one more time, get a little more geometry. Essentially, I've just created some edge loops in here, specifically so that I can grab the front and back and grab a move tool and just move those on down. You can see that just like that, we've got a hood scoop. That easy. Just throw a little hood scoop right in there. And so that is how easy this organic stuff is in Modo, really fast. But adding these wheel wells is actually, that would be a huge deal. It would take me 20 minutes to get those in there and get them perfectly round and everything. So here's what we're going to do. I'm going to go file, save, or actually, sorry, one other thing I forgot to mention. So right now I have this car body all set up, and I have the wheels in here. And I do not want to export those wheels in my OBJ file. Okay, so it's important that your OBJ file have only the geometry that you're trying to export. So I'm going to go ahead and make a new document. I'll say File New, and I'll drag that A-side surface straight into that brand new document and just bring it in. And now I have a blank document that just has that one thing in it, and that's what we need to send over. So I'll take this and say File, Save As. I can choose File, Type, and I would save over this car body to OBJ. And let's hop over to SolidWorks now, back to that assembly file. Now in this assembly, I have already inserted a blank component here, and it doesn't have anything in it, but we'll go ahead and make it visible so you can see what's not in it. And right-click it and click on the Open Part button. So now I'm inside this blank part document. I can even, I guess, show the origin so we can see where the center of this part is. We'll go File, Open. And in the what type of file do you want to open area, I'll say I want to open OBJ as T-splines. And then make sure in the options right here, when you're going to the, in the open dialog, there's an options button. I can click that, and it allows me to import the geometry into the current model if I want. I can import it into a new model or the current one. In this case, we'll do the current one. Click OK and open. Oh, got to grab the file. Open. It's going to think for a minute, slightly heavier mesh, and just like that, there it is, all brought in, ready to go. You can see how nice this geometry is. Take a look at just how clean this topology is, even though there are some n-gons and triangles and stuff in this mesh. Overall, the import is very, very clean. If I look at this with my Evaluate tab and go to the zebra stripes, you'll see, as if you know how to read a zebra stripe graph, you'll know that this is a beautiful, beautiful graph. This is all very clean, very nice curvature continuous surface, all ready to use. And if I was careful about the way that I modeled this in Modo, for example, then I could very easily make this into a manufactured part. In fact, I've actually done that. I've actually sent geometry that's imported from Modo to the factory for manufacturing, and it works just fine as long as I've paid attention to draft and all that kind of stuff. So I've imported this, and now I'm going to fast forward a little bit. I've actually already got some sketches in this document all prepared and ready to go. So I can show you just how easy this is. I'll go to my Surfaces tab and click on Trim Surface up at the top. I'll grab this sketch here, this with the wheel wells, as my trim tool, and then just click on the parts of this mesh that I want to, in this case, I'm going to do the parts I want to remove. And I'll just click here and here. And why don't we click on the other side too? We'll get this one and that one and click OK. And there we have it. We have our wheel wells knocked in just like that. Snap of your fingers. Really, really easy. Let me hide this surface for the moment down here and close this document so we'll jump back to my main assembly so we can see it in situ. And here it is. We've got our wheels in there. The whole thing is ready to rock. Now, obviously, this is just a surface. It's not solid, so we wouldn't be able to send it for rapid prototyping. We could send it for machining. If we wanted to machine something out of a block of foam, this surface would suffice. But if we're wanting to send this to SLA or FDM or Z Corp or whatever it is you're using to do your rapid prototyping, you're going to need a wall thickness on this guy. So let me open this up and demonstrate something for you real quick. Now, these surfaces, these faces, are first-class citizens in SolidWorks. So I can take these faces, I can say offset surface, grab any one of these and offset it however far I want, and I can use that surface to do other stuff. I can take this and go to, say, my top plane and, I don't know, let's sketch a just a little box for the heck of it. And I'm just going to say features, extrude, and extrude that new box I just drew. You know, we're just doing a regular old box extrude. Except, it's not where I thought it was. Okay, so here's a great example of parametric modeling at work. I'll just edit that sketch and look normal to the plane this time so I can see what I'm doing. Move this over so it is fully underneath that surface I just created. And then edit this feature. And I can actually just say, instead of going blind a certain distance, I can tell this extrusion to go up to surface, and it'll go straight up to that surface and stop. And now I've created a solid body that's utilizing this T-spline surface as its parent. So very cool stuff there. Let's delete this because I don't need it. What we really want to do is make car body into a solid in its own right. And actually, that's going to be a little bit more difficult, because this car body actually has some pretty tight, sharp little details on it. And when we go to offset this car body, it's not going to like offsetting those details. So let me show you what I mean. I'm going to go back so you get rid of those sketches so they're not cluttering up our view here. We can hide that origin point too. And if I wanted to offset this entire thing, it's going to have to offset, for example, this surface. Now, I could offset that outward, but what if I wanted to offset that 3 millimeters inward to the inside? Let's take a look at what's going on in here. If you look at this surface, see how when it offsets it, it actually inverts on itself right here. It's inverting because this corner is so sharp that it actually inverts on itself as soon as you try to offset it. So when I click OK, SolidWorks is going to warn me and say, look at that. I love demos and how they always prove you wrong. Well, you know what? That one worked, but I'm telling you for certain, if I try to do this whole thing, it will not work. Let's go ahead and try it. I'm going to do my offset surface. Grab that surface body, offset it 3 millimeters inward, click OK, and watch this prove me wrong. I would love to be proven wrong, but I don't think I will be. Thinking. This is another reason it's going to think really hard. It's going to be really difficult for it to offset this thing, because it is a lot of geometry, but mainly because it's got all these sharp corners, and it really struggles to offset sharp corners like that. There we go. So it just warned me, popped up a little bubble, and said, no, sorry, I can't do that. So here's the thing. I've created this model, but I need a wall thickness, and it doesn't have to be a perfect wall thickness. It just has to be offset by about 3 millimeters, plus or minus a half millimeter. Doesn't really matter if I'm just doing a rapid prototype. And even for manufacturing, plus or minus a tenth of a millimeter or something, if it's a toy or something that's, where it doesn't really matter the wall thickness, if the wall thickness is perfect, you can definitely get away with it. So check this out. I'll go back over to my Modo document. Let's see if we can find that. Modo, where is it? Is this it? There it is. Okay. So here's my Modo document, and what I'm going to do is actually offset this in Modo. So let's unsubdivide this. You can see the raw cage data. You can see how blocky it looks. This is when I don't hit the tab key. You know, I hit the tab key, it smooths it out. Hit the tab key again, it goes back to being all faceted. I can hop this over into wireframe mode so that we can see what's going on here. And when I offset this, the same thing is going to happen. So here, let me duplicate this mesh just so we can watch this happen in the background. I'll go to my deform tools and down here to the push tool and just click and drag the viewport to push this, and you can see that it's pushing this geometry inward. Essentially, it's the same as offset. It's just offsetting the surface inward. If I offset it inward by, let's say we want to go -3 millimeters. If we look here in the corners, this is actually inverting too. Let me go back to OpenGL mode. See how we're getting this big bubble all the way around the outside edge? The same problem applies in Modo that applies in SolidWorks. Whenever you offset a sharp edge, weird things are going to happen. So what we have to do is fix that sharp edge so that it's not going to be a problem for us. And that's actually easy. So I'll just grab one of these edges and backspace to delete it. Grab this other edge, backspace to delete it. And now we don't have that problematic geometry anymore. There's another one down here that's going to give us the same problem. So I'll do that. Get rid of those guys. And now when I run my push tool and push this guy in by -3 millimeters, spacebar to drop the tool, and look at this guy. It's actually now nice and clean all the way around the edge. And if I hit the tab on this, you'll see that we now have an offset or a B surface. We call the exterior surfaces A surfaces in industrial design. The interior surfaces are called B surfaces. In fact, I can hit the F key to flip that so you can see the inside of it. Basically, that's going to act as the inside. And I'll grab the A side and let's see, grab all this geometry tab key. And now you can see we have, I'll select both. We have both an outside and an inside to this guy that's 3 millimeters offset roughly from the outside. Now it's not exact because we did delete geometry and, you know, things aren't exactly the same. There'll be some variance. But it's probably close enough. In fact, it's for what we're doing, it's like close enough. So here, I'm going to go and just grab this B side surface. Select the bottom edge loop around the bottom and go to the right view. And then move this on down. Let's just grab this and move it down so that it's at least as low as the other one, because we're going to trim these. Then I'll delete that other surface, the A surface, so we're just exporting that B surface. And then File, Save As. Save as an OBJ file. Go to Card Body 2, and I'll just rename this one Card Body 2 B Sides. Save, and save. And back to our SolidWorks part. So here we are back in SolidWorks. I'll go to my file open again. And once again, I want to import into the same part. So I'm going to say import OBJ as T-Spline. Grab that Car Body 2 B-Sides OBJ file. Make sure that in the options it says import geometry into current model. Click OK and open. Think for a second. And now if we look in here, we should have two. Oh. Looks like it may have. Did I mess up? I think I might have messed something up because these look like they are the same. Well, that's a shame. Hate it when that happens. Hate to get stuck in demo hell. Don't you love that? When things don't go the way you want. All right, let's try this again. Go back to Modo. Okay, that is that B-side surface, and we'll just save that. Go back to SolidWorks. And just for fun, I'm going to go back before this guy. Say File, Open. OBJ's T-Spline, we'll grab that B-sides file, which should be the right one. Let's hope it works this time. If it doesn't, we'll go to Plan B. That looks more right, hopefully. Show that original one. Ah, I flipped it. Wonderful. Okay, well that's fine, we can fix that. So I'm going to select that first one that I've imported and do insert features move slash copy. Oh, I'm going to need an element here. Let me create a an axis. Having to work on the fly here. Sorry about that, folks. Sometimes these things happen, though, I guess. You know how that goes. All right, well, I've got an axis now, so I can say insert features move copy. I'll select that first imported one because I know it's backwards. Let's see, it is that one. There we go. And I want to rotate. And we'll rotate around this axis that I just added. Rotate 180 degrees. Click OK. And hopefully these things line up. What the heck? This makes no sense. Makes no sense. Okay. Well, sorry, folks. It appears I've had a mix-up and apparently messed up my files and brought in the wrong thing at some point. And possibly, I don't know. I don't know what's going on here. Anyway, let's make a solid out of this anyway, just for fun. I was going to import the offset surface, and I promise it works. In fact, I have a tutorial video where it does work, because it does normally work perfectly well. Maybe I'll try again later after we get through all this other stuff and see if I can fix it if anybody wants me to. Anyway, the point was going to be I can bring in an offset surface to act as inside of this guy. And let's just improvise here. I'm going to show this new stuff and bring back that surface. I have a bottom surface here. All I was going to do is take that offset surface that I created, run my trim surface tool, do a mutual trim. I can select this outer surface and this bottom surface. Go down here to the next stage and select the parts I want to keep. Just click I want to keep the top of the car. And I want to keep, go around here to the bottom. I want to keep the bottom of the car as well. And click OK. And now I have one manifold surface. I can take that and run my thicken tool with that selected. And there's this checkbox here for create solid from enclosed volume, which is incredibly handy. That will take this entire volume and make it into a solid. So now if we look at this in section view, you'll see this is all filled in, therefore all solid. So I can actually start to do solid operations on this guy. I want to. So here, for example, I can let's go ahead and do cut with surface, just so we're working on half of this guy at a time. I'll take the right plane, just cut off half of the model, and then do in features, I'll do an extruded cut and grab this wheel well geometry, wheel well sketch, that is. Whoops. Looks like I missed it. Grab this sketch and do an extruded cut. And I'll offset the start point for the extrude so that it's out here. Looks like I've got some previous version of this mesh in here. I think that's why this stuff isn't lining up properly, because obviously the wheel well is cutting the wrong way in here. That's weird. Anyway, I could come in a little bit and cut out this wheel well. And you can see the back one worked fine. Turn off my shadows. Back one worked fine. The front one doesn't line up right. So I can probably fix that. Let's find out. Let's just try this on the fly. Actually, let's do one more thing, and then I'll come back and show you that I think I can actually fix this if I can get it to work. So let's show you this one last thing, and then come back to this, because I think you see the basic principle here that I can turn this into a solid and then do solid operations on it. So let's do one more thing. I'm going to go back to Modo. Make a new Modo document. In fact, no, you know, I'll just use this one. No, let's do a new one. Ha, sorry about that. Okay. Thrown asunder by these little tech glitches, you can never You never know what's going to happen. So in Modo, we now have these new things called P-subs, or Pixar sub-Ds in Modo. And Pixar sub-Ds added some really cool stuff. So I'm going to hit Shift-Tab in Modo to make this into a P-sub model. Now, to the layperson, this P-sub model is going to look pretty much identical to the regular sub-D model that I created earlier. But there are some really important differences, one of which being that with a P-sub model, I can select the subdivision weight channel of this guy, run the weight tool, and actually add an edge weight to one of these. So check that out. I'm actually able to sharpen these individual edges to my heart's content, which is very cool. You used to be able to sort of do that in with regular sub-Ds, but it was not reliable, and I never recommended that anyone do it. With Pixar sub-Ds, it's a game changer. Now you can use these edge weights, and they're fantastic. So, but there's another thing that P-subs brings that's arguably even cooler. I'm going to open up the sculpting palette here and take a look down here under multi-resolution. I check multi-resolution for this mesh, and now I'm able to do some different stuff. I'm going to pick up my Wacom pen here. I'm actually on a Wacom tablet. I do most of the time these days. I'll grab, say, the push tool. I can right-click in the viewport to resize that brush. I'm going to turn symmetry on the X. Come out here, and I can just start painting details onto this guy. I can hold the Shift key while I'm painting to smooth. Hold the Control key to push in, or then pull back out. You can see this is a little bit jaggy, right? I might want it to have a little bit more detail. So I can increase the max subdivision level to 5, and now I get much nicer, much crisper detail. Come here and add whatever kind of details I want. Say I'm really liking this for some reason. This is really starting to do it for me. So we got a cool little thing started here. And I can grab, say, the flatten tool. Flatten tool is one of my favorites. Freaking love it. And I can just like flatten out part of this mesh, you know, to kind of add some flat areas to add some dynamic feeling to this guy, make it look a little bit more like maybe it was pinched out of clay. And so I can work on this as much as I want ad nauseum. Here I'll add my carve tool and actually take a harder brush and sort of create a nice little hole in here. Create another one out on the side of the head. So we got some cool stuff going here. Nice, like it. And now I can actually go and do what's called a freeze. I can geometry freeze this guy. Click OK. And all of that mesh data is actually turned into its individual polygons. So here, this is just a regular old polygon mesh now. No P-subs involved anymore. It's just a mesh. And I can export this mesh and import it into SolidWorks if it works right. So let's say save as, I'm just in that same folder, there's an OBJ. We'll save it as my test sculpt 2 OBJ. Head back over to SolidWorks. Let's see if I can switch. Oops. All right. I'll just close this up. We don't need to save that. Say file open once again. Down here at the bottom, we'll say OBJ as T-spline. And grab the test sculpt 2 OBJ and open. Think for a second. There's a lot of polygons in there. It's got to do a little bit of thinking. And there we go. In SolidWorks. I hope you're applauding right now. because that is wicked cool. I just imported a mesh with edge weighting and with sculpting straight into SolidWorks. And check this out. This is a full-blown solid within SolidWorks. So I could go ahead and come over here to my, let's say, my right plane. You can see it look normal to the plane. Remember, I just carved in this circle right here on the side of the head. We'll just go ahead and put a hole right through this guy. This is going to be anticlimactic because now you have seen me make a hole before, and you know what it's like. We'll do mid-plane, go all the way out on both sides. And then we could come in here and like fill at the edges. I'll just fill at that face so that we get edges filleted on both sides, 15 millimeters, let's say. Click OK. And we have now created some little bead or something that is ready to use in a mechanical assembly. Doesn't matter what it is. So if you want to sculpt something in Modo, bring it into SolidWorks, and then use that in the context of an assembly, it's all gravy. Fantastic. And you can see how nice this import is. See, we get this whole face all at once, one big, beautiful face. Really nice import. So I'm going to go back and try to fix this other thing. If you have questions, feel free to start throwing them out there, because at this point, I'm about done with the basic demo part, and I would just love to move into whatever discussion we might want to have.
Yeah, we got some good questions, so I think I'll start asking a couple here.
Yeah, go for it.
Let's start here. First of all, do you prefer Modo over Rhino and T-Splines?
I personally do, I have to say. I mean, there's definitely different ways of thinking about this. If you are a Rhino aficionado and you use Rhino all the time and you don't have any interest in SolidWorks, then this makes no sense to you. You would definitely want to keep using Rhino, and that's fine. I personally much prefer Modo's modeling to T-Splines for Rhino, just because it's a much more robust, it's much more developed editing environment. So, for example, switch this back over to Modo. I want to show you an example here. So here's something that I've created. So say I've modeled this in Modo, and or I've got this mesh and it's a T-spline in SolidWorks and I want to edit it. Well, if I were in T-splines for Rhino, first of all, this would barely be editable. It would just be too darn heavy to do anything with it. Secondly, making edits to meshes like this is something that programs like Modo have been working on for years. So they've worked out really great ways of doing it that, to my knowledge, aren't available in T-splines for Rhino. So I would, for example, check this out. I'll do my radial falloff again. Drag out a radial falloff over here and do a scaling operation, and I can just scale just that back part of the head. And if I want to, I could even bring in tool properties here, change my radial falloff to a smooth profile so that it smoothly comes in and smoothly goes out of the transformation. And I can make changes to or big global deformations to geometry just like that. And there are tons of other examples of things like that where I just find that a sub-D modeler is a more robust solution. That said, T-Splines for Rhino is a fantastic tool. And for simple modeling with the types of meshes that T-Splines is meant to work with, I don't mean to denigrate at all its capabilities. It's a very robust package. I just personally would prefer to use Modo.
Okay, cool. Is it possible to surface a point cloud in a sub-D program such as Modo and then edit the surface in SolidWorks?
I wouldn't recommend trying that because, the point cloud is going to come in as a total mess, and if it comes in with polygons, they'll be triangles and will not translate well into SolidWorks. So here's one of the things that probably bears mentioning, and I'm sorry that the demo kind of fell flat with the car. Unfortunately, and it's too difficult to actually try to fix it now. But here's the basic thing. So T-Splines likes to bring in clean meshes. You can see there's a lot of polygons here. Yes, there are many of them, but they are, for the most part, four-sided. And none of them overlap each other. And they are all clean polygons. And what I mean by clean polygons is, for example, a lot of sub-D modelers or a lot of just mesh modelers in general will do this messy stuff where they like take a cylinder, for example, and they'll pull out something like this. And let's see, take this mesh and cut it, make a new mesh, paste it in, and then go to my mesh edit and mesh edit, come down here to my Boolean tools, do a Boolean subtract with the background. And now I've actually done a Boolean, right? So you can see that that hole did get knocked out, of the sculpt, and it worked. It looks fine in Modo. And a lot of Viz guys are like, well, it's good enough. We'll get away with it. But in CAD, this is a mess, and we would not be able to use it. And if you try to import this into T-splines, this would not fly because you can see that these edges are gross where this Boolean took place. FYI, I basically never use Booleans in Modo ever. I've modeled some pretty complex stuff. I've done cars, I've done all kinds of things, and I avoid Booleans like the plague. And so that's one of the things. People have sent me models and said, why won't this import into T-splines? And they've done Booleans all over the place, and you know, you're not going to be able to use that. T-splines likes clean, simple, mostly quad meshes. You can add N-gons or whatever as long as they're clean. It doesn't like points that are really close together, and it doesn't like points that are overlapping or extremely twisted. So you want to keep the meshes pretty regular.
Okay. Let's see. Is it possible to import a TS object with its own origin within SolidWorks?
If I understand the question, a clarification would be great. It does come in at the same origin, and then you could translate it from there to wherever you want. So if you're, I'm assuming what they mean is, for example, if I take this guy right now, he's centered on the origin of my Modo document. If I go to item selection mode and I move this guy away so that the actual item center for this guy has moved to up here, and the world center is down here, I actually honestly don't know if that will come in the new location. So let's just try it. Let's say save as, save it as test sculpt, save it as test sculpt 3, OBJ. Hop back over to SolidWorks. Very cool. Close this guy up, why not? We'll just start over. And do a file open. And grab that test sculpt 3. And it would appear that the origin, yep, so the origin is down here and our guy is moved up there. So it looks like the item does import wherever the geometry happens to be in space, in Modo or whatever package it happens to be. So, but I don't think there's an item center that comes in with this. That's the thing. I don't think anywhere in here is the origin for this part. So if you're wanting to import it and have its own origin, what you would need to do actually is just think like a parametric modeler, which is I'm going to model on the origin and then use an assembly to move the component somewhere else. So you know, if the person asking the question is used to use this in SolidWorks, then I would recommend doing it that way. If you're not, you might want to look into it.
Okay, cool. Let's get to a couple more here.
Well, obviously we're way under time, so go ahead.
Yeah. Is there a kind of push button to bridge these, like the ones integrated into Space Claim and Rhino?
No, there's not.
No. Okay. Let's see here. Can you bring the Modo?
It'd be nice if there were. Hint, hint, Nick.
Yeah. So, yeah. Can you bring the Modo surface after other features are in the SolidWorks model, or does it have to be the first feature?
It doesn't have to be the first feature. It's just an import feature. It can happen anywhere you want. In most cases, I work with it. I tend to put them at the beginning, but you can definitely put them anywhere in the tree you like. Here, I'll just go ahead and add one right before this just to prove it, but I'll show you that it works. Just extrude this guy right up and hop out of there. So we got a little cylinder, and there's our feature right after it. So yes, at any point in the model, you can bring it in.
Okay, cool. Here we go. May we define a specific tolerance value when creating the OBJ from Modo for precise models?
Well, so that's an interesting question. It's kind of a loaded question because you're not really going to do precision modeling so much in Modo. You can do it to an extent, but in sub-D modelers overall are not intended for precision modeling. So let me show you a little bit about what I mean by that, so I'm not just making stuff up here. I'll make a new document and show you that, you know, when you're making a cube, for example, I can drag out a cube and within reason I can define this cube to be whatever I want. You can see over here on my screen I can actually position it numerically so that its position is at 0, 0, 0, and its size 32.6 millimeters by 28.2 by 23.4. And that is reliable. Those dimensions are perfect and exact. And when they come into SolidWorks, they will be pretty much perfect and exact. The thing is that subd, once you hit the tab key, I mean, yes, this cube was a certain size, and yes, it still is a very particular size. Here, I'll go and show, if I go to my view menu, I can show the dimensions tool. So this is currently, look at that, the dimensions tool doesn't even show me the actual size of the thing unless I freeze it. It'll only show me the subdivided size. So you can see that, I mean, this is not intended for precise numeric models. But that said, if you do, and I do sometimes make models that are pretty darn close and bring those in, it's pretty tight. The tolerance is pretty nice. Just keep in mind that the subdivision algorithm that you're using in Modo or in whatever subd package you're using might be slightly different than the algorithm used for T-splines, and therefore the resulting surface, the curvature on the surface, will be slightly different.
Okay, cool. So I think I'm going to go ahead and switch the screen back over, unless there's anything else you wanted to show, Adam, real quick.
I don't know. What do you
I mean, maybe something quick for just 5 minutes. Right here, we got another one more quick question here. How is tsElements different from Modo for a SolidWorks kit?
Oh.
That makes sense.
Excuse me. They're completely different. But that's an excellent question, actually. So first of all, the SolidWorks kit for Modo is a way of importing SolidWorks geometry into Modo. And the tsElements is a way of getting geometry from Modo out to SolidWorks. So it's kind of the opposite, actually. But the point is, let's go back to my SolidWorks document real quick. Find that FastMax assembly. We'll go back to that main assembly file. I'm going to hide that original guy and bring back the first one that I did. And I just want to show it to you just to prove it. It does work. I put it in there. You can see I have a wall thickness, right? It's nearly perfect 3 millimeter wall thickness all the way around. And I did this using that technique that I just failed to do for you, which was to offset it in Modo and bring it in here and then stitch it all up. And it's now a solid with an offset. So I promise you it does work. There's something funny about what I did, some weird step I took. And so anyway, I'm just going to take this and save it. So just do file save. Hop back over to Modo now. Oops, I've got to do it from here. Keep forgetting. And now let's close up all these documents. We've got a bunch of open documents here. Just get them out of the way. Now, one of the things that is cool about Modo and that I've always loved about Modo is that it does, it has for a very long time, been able to open native SolidWorks documents. It can also open native Rhino documents as well. It's a really beautiful workflow. So if I say file open here, I can just open up SolidWorks file. We'll grab my SolidWorks assembly file, click open. Wait for a second while it chugs, because it's going to bring in a lot of data. Zoom in here, and you can see it has brought in that SolidWorks file. Now, what it has brought in is the OpenGL mesh from SolidWorks. And the OpenGL mesh is obviously pretty ugly. It's got a lot of triangles and whatever. But I promise you this, if you render it, it actually looks gorgeous. It renders just fine. Anyway, when you do file open without the SolidWorks kit, it brings in your most basic information. But if we look here at just this main body, I'm going to hide these others for a second. So we're just looking at that main body document. It's brought in this main body as one big mesh item where everything in it is all in one. What the SolidWorks kit allows me to do is instead of that, I can say SolidWorks menu, import as bodies, and I could say light or heavy. I'll do light for now. And go to my FastMax import. We'll grab the body, just the body, and open it. It's chugging for a second while it thinks. Okay, here we go. So now I've imported that document, and if I expand this, you'll see that I actually have now a separate static mesh item for each body within that file, which is really handy. There are a lot of things like that in the SolidWorks kit for Modo that improve drag and drop functionality. They improve all kinds of things for importing SolidWorks data. I only highly recommend it. If you're working back and forth between Modo and SolidWorks, owning tsElements and also owning the SolidWorks kit for Modo is pretty much a must as far as I'm concerned. They're both fantastic products.
All right, cool. I'm going to switch the screen back over to mine and wrap things up here. So
great.
Just do that.
Well, thanks, everybody. I appreciate the time. Glad you could join us.
So many thanks to you, Adam. That was really, truly fascinating stuff. Really, I'm sure everyone out there found it as interesting as I did. I want to thank everyone who attended this presentation of Novedge's Best of the Best webinar series. Just in case, if you're unfamiliar with us at Novedge, we're the leading online design software superstore. Not only do we have the best prices around, but our staff is awesome. You can call, chat with us at any time. Another thing I'd like to draw your attention to is a bit of information that's a benefit to you guys out there. Here at Novedge, we love to go above and beyond for the design community. By doing so, we've created several communities to foster collaboration, coordination between design professionals. One community, the one showing on your screen here, is WikiCAD. It'd be interesting to all of you. It's pretty much the place for all CAD users. You can come. It's free. It's easy to join. Easy to sign up. When you do, you have instant access to all the latest information, trends, news, videos, tutorials, all things CAD. This webinar will be made available there. It's really a great resource, and it's totally free, so I encourage all of you to join if you get the chance. So, yeah, I mean, having said all that, if anyone has any questions, my email's up there, vince@novedge.com. Maybe you had a question that didn't get answered during the Q&A. I'd love to hear from you. Adam, I don't know if you had anything else you wanted to say real quick just to wrap things up. Or maybe even Nick.
Well, I don't.
You're there.
Thanks for your time. It's been fantastic. Make sure to check out cadjunkie.com. Got to plug that again. Thanks again.
Oh, yeah, definitely we'll get that. Everyone get over there. It's actually a tremendous resource as well. I spend a lot of time there as well. So.
Oh, good. Glad to hear it.
Having said all that, I want to thank everyone, and we'll see you next time.
All right. Thanks again.